All right, welcome to Android Zombies, How Not to Get Bit. I'm going to start off a little bit about me. I've been a native Android developer for about 2 years. I work at Worldwide Technology Asynchrony Labs. I'm based out of St. Louis. My path to computer science isn't the typical one. I actually come from a mathematical background, and I caught the bug. I've released 4 production Android apps in my last 2 years for clients as well as my own personal projects. And in my free time, you'll find me racing bikes in small circles really fast. So today we're going to cover a couple things. We're going to talk about Android zombies. We're going to learn what exactly is an Android zombie, how are they created. We're going to find ways and strategies that we could use to test our apps. And then we're going to find ways to recover from being a zombie app and present our users with a good user experience. All right, so what is an Android zombie? Zombie correlation goes really well with what an Android zombie is. You have an app that's been killed and it's been recreated and it's shambling around trying to give crashes to your users, presenting them with bad user experience and generally not being a very nice friend in the Android ecosystem. So Android zombies are created, like I said, when the system kills our process. So Android, at any time when your app is backgrounded, reserves the right to destroy your process. When you come back to it via either the launcher or your recent task list, it tries to recreate the process wherever it was. So this is not your configuration change. So this is different than configuration change. So configuration change, for those that don't know, is the things like rotating your device, walking in and out of a Bluetooth keyboard connection, walking in and out of a Bluetooth car connection where the UI is torn down and recreated. This is your application is being torn down and recreated. Handling it and what happens to your application is very similar between the two. And so practices that are good for recovering from process death are also good for recovering from application death. Not all patterns for recovering from configuration change and bringing your view back up are necessarily good for returning from process death, though. All right, so symptoms that your users will see when you've been bitten by a zombie is the first one, the application is just going to crash on first launch. Something is not there that it was expecting to be there because your process has been torn down. All of your global data and state and models, they're all gone and they've been recreated. So you end up in the middle of some workflow that requires some data and your application crashes. Secondary one is you'll see some partially populated data. Maybe you had some model and you're in the middle of a workflow and it's expecting the data to be pre-populated. It's not going to be there on the screen anymore, and so your user will see some null value or just blank things and present them a bad UI. This kind of leads to a third thing where then when they try and interact with one of these bad or stale objects, the application is going to crash. So it doesn't crash immediately sometimes, but it crashes on first user interaction or further down the process. The third kind of, and I think this is the worst one, is when you come back and you're presenting bad data, if one of these interactions does an unchecked operation to a database or something, you could be saving this bad junk data to the database, and then this user can never recover from it unless they go to their system settings and clear the app data or uninstall and reinstall your app. And so unless you have really good crash logging and error handling inside of your application, you're going to be giving a bad UI, and you'll have no insight into what's happening. You'll just see bad reviews. I use this app and it was great for a week and now it no longer works. All right, so some kind of warning signs that danger is nearby is global data. This is your in-memory models. So you'll see common patterns of people storing objects in their application class or in classes injected from their injection framework or in static singletons to pass data between screens. So that way, when they're in the middle of a workflow, they're like, oh, I could just reach over here and grab it out of memory. When this happens and your application's torn down, all of those classes are gone and they're recreated fresh. Retained fragments are also another one. Sometimes people use retained fragments to handle configuration change and rotation for persisting their view because it persists the view and it recreates the view on configuration change. However, when your application's killed and comes back, these retained fragments are recreated. So all of the data that was stored in that retained fragment is now gone. So it gives you a false sense of security that you're handling these types of things. And rotation is kind of your quickest way to test configuration change. And so when you feel like you're handling rotation, you may not be handling application death. Similarly, static members within your activities and fragments. This is something that you have to handle in configuration change because your activities and fragments are torn down and recreated, but you also have to handle it in process death because not only is your process dying, but all of your views, all of your activities, all of your fragments, they're also dying. And then this is kind of the reason why you're going to be crashing or experiencing a bad user experience is this last one. The activities and fragments are relying on this previous state to be set up. So if they're reaching into memory and trying to pull objects out and it's not there and presenting it to the user, that's when you're going to see your crashes. So if you see any of these in your app, not necessarily all of them are bad patterns. They all have their uses. But when you're using these patterns, you just have to be aware that this is a use case that you'll need to handle. All right, so first things first, how exactly do we test this? In our development lifecycle, a lot of times we're working on emulators, we're working on physical phones, and a lot of us have really nice phones because we want the latest and greatest because we're kind of tech geeks. And it's hard to recreate these conditions. So if you want to test your app and make sure that you're handling process death and recreation, you're going to have to use some utilities. So the first one is to background your app and open some resource-intensive app that's going to kill it. So this is what your users are experiencing in the field. Maybe they have a budget phone, and every time they change apps, they're experiencing process death because it doesn't have very much RAM. Or maybe they have 150 Chrome tabs open, and it takes up so much memory that every time they pull open Chrome, it just shuts down all the apps in the background. So these are just some of the apps that can kind of help you with this. Nothing against them, because they are all great apps. And honestly, for some of the games in Netflix, if they're not shutting down your app while it's in the background, it means they're not doing their job right, because they want to be showing the best, most enriching, engaging features that they can. They want high definition, they want videos out, so good for them. If they're helping me shut down my app, that's great, because they're giving me a great user experience while I'm in their app. Okay, so there's several pros and cons to doing this method. The big pro is, this is the most realistic one. This is what your users are seeing. This is how this is happening in the wild. The cons, it's really hard to get this to happen. It's non-deterministic. Some phones, I've never been able to get this to kill it. Open 150 Chrome tabs, all watching YouTube, and it'll never shut down an app. Other phones, it happens more frequently. But unless you have good logging and you're watching ADB or Logcat and seeing when process death happens and when your application is killed, you don't even know if it's happened. So verifying that your process was killed and you're recovering is hard. Right, so there's better ways that we could do this. So a secondary feature that I use for quite a while is to use another app to fill RAM and force low memory conditions on my devices. So there's probably many others out there, but this is one that I used. It was developed by Teaspoon, and he uses Android NDK to fill up RAM and force low memory conditions. And it's open source, so you could either clone it or download it from the Play Store. And this is about as close to real as you're going to get. You're filling up RAM, forcing low memory. You have somewhat more repeatable results, but you still end up with this non-deterministic nature. Some devices and some manufacturers are so good at managing memory and resources that your application still isn't going to be killed. So doing this across all devices, or even just the devices you have available, you may not be able to get repeatable results here. So this isn't the end all. The third one I like to call the Samsung font style trick. And for the longest time, this is the method I used. And I recorded a demonstration of how to do this. So Samsung has this really nice feature where at the operating system level, you could change your font. So if your application is using Roboto, somebody go there and say, I really like Wingdings, and inject Wingdings into your application unless you're explicitly saying, use my company's font. When it does that, every time an application is brought up, it tears itself completely down and recreates itself, because now it want, the user said, hey, use Wingdings instead of Roboto. So in order to do this, you're going to go to settings. You're going to scroll down to display where you would change the font size. And there is a setting called font style. And you'll see it comes up with some fonts that gives you examples, like Choco Cookie. And then you go ahead and change your device to Choco Cookie. Now you see everything just changed. And then when somebody opens up your app, they'll see Choco Cookie. And this is great for when you're trying to test your branding's font styles. If you put Choco Cookie and you see it anywhere in your app, you know, hey, I need to put my own brand font in there. But also, the secondary thing is it kills all the processes. So this has some pros and cons too. It's deterministic. So this is the first way that we could reliably create this. And it was fairly quick. It took about 30 seconds. So when I test this, hey, 30 seconds, I could kill my process, bring it back, and I could see if this one screen handles process death or this one workflow. But if I wanted to start testing all of my workflows or all of my screens, this is going to be hours of effort. It works on all applications, which is also a con, because maybe there's a secondary application I'm working with, and they have a bug where they don't handle this, and I want to test integration with them. Well, I just killed their process as well. So that's a con. And then we got to put up with these funny fonts all over our phone. And it only works on Samsung devices. So if we don't have Samsung devices available, which if you don't, we all should, because that's 85% of the market or something like that. So we should all be testing against Samsung devices, even if we don't have them in our pocket. But you don't always have one available and handy for testing. So there's kind of a fourth layer that I think is even better than this. And this is using developer options. So hidden down in there, in developer options, we have several things, like we have don't keep activities on the back stack. It's not this. So that's going to make sure that activities in the background are created or destroyed and recreated. What we want is our process to be destroyed and recreated. So kind of hidden down at the developer options level, and I have another example here. So you go into your settings, scroll down, find developer options, and then you're going to be scrolling for a few days because they really buried it here. And it's not 100% obvious when you first see it. There is a limit background processes, and you'll say no background processes. And then you leave, do your work, make sure that your application came back, because when you said no background processes, you're already in the background. You've been destroyed, so when you go back to your application, it'll experience recreation, and you'll land right back where you were in the app. All right, so this has pros and cons too. This is deterministic, so it's going to shut down your application every time. It works on all devices, so now we could test on emulators, we could test on non-Samsung devices. So this kind of puts us in a better state. The big con is this top one. I accidentally left it on end of day. When I came back to work, I spent 3 hours trying to figure out why my app isn't working. What bug did we write last week when we shipped? And I've actually experienced this one. Somebody turned it on testing, went and put the device away, pulled it back, and it's kind of hidden down there. And so it took a while to realize, hey, when I go in the background and come back, I'm experiencing application recreation. And it still is destroying all background processes, not just your app. So if your app is relying on other background services, those are gone too. And services aren't destroyed as greedily as applications are. So a lot of times they'll survive even though your application is killed. So we can still do better. So this fifth option is to use a utility to targetedly just terminate my application. So there's one on GitHub. I went ahead and wrote it for my team to use. And it's also on the Google Play Store. It's open source. It's super simple. It's maybe 25 lines of code. But it works. And here's a demonstration of this one. So here I am. I'm in an application that I want to kill, bring it down. I bring up the app terminator, select the application that I want to destroy, and then destroy it. And then when I come back to my target application, the process is going to be recreated from disk. And so you'll notice that video was 18 seconds, much quicker than the 30 or 45 seconds that we were experiencing before for testing this workflow. And we're only killing our process. So kind of a big aha moment, this is awesome. But there are some cons. Namely, it was probably made by an evil and nefarious developer, and I would not trust that guy. So. You guys can view the source on GitHub if you don't. All right, so we've kind of gone over what Android does when it's destroying our processes. We've gone over how we can test it and what happens, what the dangers are. It's essentially global data in memory models. So now we're going to talk about what are some ways that we could gracefully fail and give our users the experience they're expecting when they're coming back to our application. So kind of the first one is to just seamlessly recover. And so what's required for this one is making sure that instead of storing all of your models and all of your data in memory, that you're relying on disk persistence. And there's a couple different ways you could do this. And there's some special considerations that we have to be aware of. So we're going to store all of our models on disk, and we're going to pull them back from disk whenever we need to use them. And maybe our requirements don't allow us to do this because we don't want user data stored on disk, and we have security concerns. So maybe we can't store all the data that we need to recreate. So if our requirements don't allow this, then we have to consider other options. But for apps where we can do this, this is a great solution. All right, so the first one is kind of going back to Android 101. So when we all went through the initial Android developer training, and they told us, hey, we want to go from activity A to activity B, how do we do it? We use intents, and when we're passing data to a fragment, we're going to use bundles, and when we want to do configuration change, we're going to use save instance state. So Android handles writing all this to disk for you. And so when your process dies and you're in the background, and you come back, it's coming all back from disk. So this is great. It's easy. Kind of standard Android. A lot of us get away from it, though, because we think of better patterns. The cons for this are you have parsable generation for your models. And this takes time. And there's utilities to auto-generate the parsables, but some of those have bugs. And then you have to maintain it. So anytime that one of your models updates, you have to make sure that you delete all of your parsable generation, recreate it to make sure that you're parsing all of your model and not just portions of it. And then with the release of NuGet, there's this issue with the transaction too large exception. So there's only so much space the Android operating system can use for each app for storing save instance state. And as your workflows get longer and you have more complex UIs with more fragments, bigger task stacks and back stacks, it's saving more and more data. And when it eventually you reach a tipping point where you get a transaction too large exception. Now, pre-NuGet, it used to just give you a warning. And who knows what it did, because something happened and they're warning you about it. Maybe you lost some data and you'd crash eventually, but I don't know. But now on NuGet, it just crashes your app. So you start trying to background your app and it's just like, nope, you're done, and you get a crash. So this is great for smaller apps and simple apps, and until you have the issue of transaction too large exception, it's great. Second option is instead of leveraging intents and bundles to save all of our state, we can save just enough to refresh what we need. So here you're saving just your user ID or just the row of the product that you're wanting to look up or just the category that you're wanting to look up. And then when you get a fresh start, if you don't have the data there, hey, let's go to the server, let's pull it down. You still get the pros of Android persisting the data for you on disk. It sets up gracefully handling configuration change as well. And it also mitigates the risk of transaction too large exception, but it doesn't completely get rid of it. You still have to worry about transaction too large exceptions happening because all of your recycler views and stuff, when they're saving state, a lot of times those get pretty hefty as well. And the really big con with this one is on fresh start of your application, you have to deal with networking. So as the user brings it back up, they have to go download all this content. And if they're coming back into your application with poor service, they might not see the best UI, and you have to handle how do you gracefully degrade from there. Right. So kind of secondary option from Android 101 is leverage the SQLite database. So pros about this one is it's much more robust. We can store much more data. We have access to the SD card on the device. Our models can get much larger. We could store much more data. And when we come back, we could just hey, pull those values out of the database and put them up on the screen. We could also do local caching of our server objects. So when we're coming back, we could store the keys in our intents and our bundles and then use that to go fetch the SQLite data. And you also get robust upgrade pathways. So across installs, as user upgrades to the newest version of your app, if your models change, you can write upgrade pathways to make sure that they get a seamless user experience to the next upgrade. So there's lots of benefits. Cons are early iterations of your application and your development lifecycle. It may be prohibitively expensive because we're writing databases. So if your goal is to get an app out the door in the next couple months, maybe this isn't where you want to invest your time at. And then even though upgrading is a pro, it's also a con because it's extra testing burden. Then you have to test how are we upgrading from version 4 to version 5, or how am I going from 4.1 to 4.2 or 4.1 to 4.3. You need to make sure you're doing all of these upgrade tests and giving your users good experiences there. And sometimes the bugs that are hidden for a misconfigured model in your database, they don't happen on primary use cases, so it's not until it gets out in the wild that you find the bug if you're not diligent. All right, so there's a third option, and this is using flat JSON files and writing them to disk. It's robust, like SQLite is, and we can store a lot more data, just like we can in SQLite. We can leverage the SD card. And it's quicker when you're iterating, because as your models change, hey, just write that guy to disk. So until you start seeing your models kind of gel and you kind of understand your requirements more and you get further into your application development lifecycle, you can use this method and you get much quicker iterations for your first few releases. There is a big con though, and that is the possibility of writing corrupted models. So if your application is killed or swiped away while it's writing to disk, which can be a long process, especially because you want to be doing it on a background thread and not the UI thread, you get corrupted JSON models being written to disk. When you're trying to read corrupted models back, you get crashes. You have a performance hit because you're having to do this on the background. Sometimes it could take a while to write those to disk. And then you have limited upgrade pathways. So as users going from version A to version B of your app, the kind of only solution you can give them is deleting their entire model and then giving them a new one because it's probably changed. So kind of the path I like taking here when I do this is for my first few iterations before we go to production, I'll use flat files of internal JSON. And once I start seeing my model structures and my data kind of gelling and we know where it's going, then we'll start migrating over to a database. All right, but this isn't the only one. Like I said, sometimes your requirements won't allow you to write all of this information to disk. So another way is to sense a fresh application start and just kind of kick the user back out to the splash screen or wherever your application starts. And this one, it's kind of creative because when your application is killed, remember earlier I said all of your in-memory models are gone. So if you're using an in-memory model from your injection framework or in your application class, and you kind of write on it, when your application's killed, it's erased. It's kind of like a blackboard. Well, when we come back, if we don't have it, that's our key to, hey, let's get out of here and let's start fresh. I think in a lot of instances, this is what our user expects, because this happens while our application is in the background. So maybe they're coming back an hour later, maybe they're coming back a week later, or a month later. And as a user, I don't necessarily expect to land exactly where I was last month, or even last hour. So a lot of times if they're coming back to a landing page, or a splash screen, or a home page, that's kind of the experience they expect. So it's not necessarily bad UX. A lot of times when you discuss this with developers, they think it is because when we're testing this, we background the app and we come back in 10 seconds later. We're like, man, I really want to be where I was. But in the wild, this is a totally valid scenario. All right, and then this is my favorite one, kind of a hybrid approach. So in this one, we're going to save some stuff to disk that we can, that our requirements allow us to. This is our non-sensitive data. And then when we sense a fresh application start, we're going to go back to the beginning. But then we're going to sense, where am I? What can I do? What was the user trying to do? And then bring them forward to where they expect to be. And so this could be part of your loading screen experience. So the goal is, again, to save the data on disk, but just enough to get back to where you want to go. Triage where we're at when we sense the fresh application start, and then stage an attack and bring the user forward into whatever workflow they were doing, if we can. It's much less work than full disk persistence, but it offers some of the benefits of giving the users the seamless re-entry into your app. Right, and then there's a fourth scenario, and that's anything else that makes sense for your specific use case. So these aren't prescriptive. There's other things that we could do to give UX. Whatever your design team or your development team or your product owners want to do for recovering from this, it's perfectly fine. Just as long as we're not crashing and we're not making our app land in some unusable state and we're giving good user experience to our users, that's all that matters. So if there's another creative way to solve this, by all means, use that. So, questions and discussion? No. Blasted through it. All right.
Actually, I don't know. There's a library out there, IcePick.
All right, so the question was, have I ever used IcePick?
Yeah, to do instance saving. I'm not sure if
yes.
This applies in the process.
The answer is no, I haven't.
Okay.
So IcePick does save your instance state. So that's how you can persist across configuration change. Saving your instance state also works really well for coming back from process death. There are some nuances to it, though. So one of them is if you have background services running that are coming and publishing things into your model, you don't control when save instance state was called. So you can imagine if I have a retail app, for instance, and I'm adding something to a cart, and I background the app while that's going on, and the thing is finally updated, and I have my cart over here, I'm not guaranteed that save instance state is called. And so it won't solve all the scenarios, but it's great for configuration change.
Do you have any experience with the boot complete flag?
The question is, do I have any experience with the boot complete flag? And I do not.
Does your application on the store terminate services or other processes that live within your app that you've forked out?
No, it does not.
So it'll just kill the UI process?
Yes.
Have you used ADB kill with the package name?
The question is, have I used ADB kill with the package name? And I did. And I've had several people suggest this to me as a way of killing my process while it's in the background. I've never been able to get it to recreate in this zombie state. Whenever I've done it, I've come back to the application from a clean start. It never lands me in the middle of a workflow. And some people that I've talked to about this swear by it, and they swear it works for them. So I don't know if it's me using ADB on Linux or just the versions of Android Studio, the versions of the emulators I'm using, but it's never worked for me.
Our application doesn't put the loady. We do a separate service that puts a thing on the desktop when our application is backgrounded. And in that scenario, you can kill it.
Okay. So I think you're kind of jumping the gun on me. My next slide was going to say, if you guys have other creative ways of making this happen, please let me know, because I'm really interested in this. So things like that, I'd really like to know. So my Twitter handle is on the next page. So the creative solutions that you guys have for recovering or for forcing this, please tell me, because if there's a better way than the open source app I made, I'm all for it. I'm all about getting feedback and testing feedback as quickly as possible. So,
can you go back to explain what your open source app actually does?
Yeah. So the question is, can I explain what my open source app actually does? It's super simple. It's just getting the activity manager service, and then it's looking for all debuggable applications, because if you list all of the applications, you're going to see 100 applications, and finding the one you're developing against is going to be difficult and time consuming. So it's just your debuggable applications, and then it kills it while it's in the background. And since it's in another application, you're guaranteed that that app is going to be backgrounded, unless you start doing things like split screen.
Have you ever considered using something like, rather than going full-blown as a SQL database, it seems kind of intensive for something like this, using something like Realm? Simplified?
So the question was, have I considered Realm? And I have. So SQL, there are ORM libraries, and a lot of them are great. And lots of people are using them. And they do make it faster. I think that's an alternative to doing this flat JSON file type of thing. It's just, I have some engineers that necessarily don't like some of those libraries. So. We've done several different solutions, but that's a totally valid use case. All right. Well, thanks for coming. I always appreciate feedback and further input, and I'd love to hear the creative ways that you guys are handling this. So feel free to tweet at me at mathematicalfunk. Send me messages. I'd love to hear from you. Bye.